top five action TV shows from the 70s and 80s.
Right.
I mean, it's the perfect topic for you. It's what everyone would think about when they hear Eric Martin from Mr. Big, right?
Talking about PJ Farley and Steve Brown, that's where they got that flannel shirt vibe from Johnny Depp and 21 Jump Street. I'm pretty sure.
I never thought of that. I never thought of those bastards. You heard it here. Breaking news. Blabbermouth, pick this up. Breaking news. Pick it up. I don't know. Metal Sludge. What the hell it is? I don't know what the hell websites are. Any of those metal websites, here, you heard it here first. Eric Martin said, Trickster ripped off 21 Jump Street.
Welcome to Top 5 with Joey Quesada. Starring Joey Quesada.
Team Jesus, my friend.
No! Am I walking around park?
Co-starring Ernie Palooza. And the doctor, Tommy Snyder.
Goddamn.
Now here's your host, Joey Quesada.
All right, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Top 5. I'm your host, Joey Quesada.
And I'm Hooker, TJ Hooker.
You are no hooker, my friend. You'd be not making much money, my friend. And we have a very, very special guest with us today. The one, the only, the voice of Mr. Big, Eric Martin. What's up, Eric?
What's up, guys? Hi, I'm Eric Martin's father.
Was that a nice intro or what?
That was a great intro. I thought you were going to do it your East Coast vernacular and go, Eric Martin. And I thought you were going to pull one of those.
Yo, it's Eric Martin.
It's Martin. What? Anyway.
What's up, buddy? Thanks so much for coming on.
Thank you very much. We're going to hold a mirror underneath Ernie's nose. Are you still here? Cool.
I'm here.
He's breathing. He's in space, but he can breathe.
I'm a huge fan of you guys, man. I've been watching a podcast or whatever you call this format. Am I going to see the teal green and pink porno strip 80s colors?
Oh, yes.
Later?
That'll be in later, yes. We can't record like that. That's post-production, they call it in the biz, Eric.
Is it?
Yeah, it is.
I'm not a director. I'm an actor in MTV videos. That's pretty much it. And on stage.
We have been working on a follow-up to Z-Rock called E-Rock, which would be a smash hit, I believe.
I would love that.
I would do
that. And you could be the same character that you were in Z-Rock, you know, the acting as the smart one.
Wait a minute. Was that a dig?
Kinda. You were actually, I love Z-Rock. I thought that was a fantastic show. I every time I see Pauly Z, I constantly tell him, you know, that was a great show. And he's like, Yeah, told me.
Tell me more.
Oh man, every episode, man, just fantastic. It wasn't too PC, you know, back in the day. I mean, we didn't even realize it because that's rock and roll people, you know, that's the way we talk, you know, and we're cooped up in either a tour bus or a van driving to the gigs and stuff. And it's like, you just had three guys bullshitting. And when I was doing all the tours with Mr. Big, we would talk like sailors. I'd come home, I'd have to dumb it down a little bit for my family and my kids and stuff.
Especially East Coast guys, too. East Coast guys just break, that's what you do. You break each other's balls. That's, you know, if you're complimenting each other, it means you don't like each other.
You know, your generation or our generation, let me just lump myself into that. you say breaking balls, but like, remember, I don't know if you remember this or if you're father or whoever told you back in the day, but what was doing the dozens?
I don't know. I don't know that term. Ernie, you know that?
No.
Dozens. That was like breaking balls back in the 60s. I mean, it's before your time, but like your parents and stuff.
Right, right. Oh, I never heard that. But it's all the same thing, right? I'm assuming it means breaking balls, right?
Yeah, I don't know why I threw that tidbit of useless information out. I apologize. You edit that part.
I would have guessed it meant having a 12-some.
Doing the dozens. Ernie, I like that.
Hey, let's just, so we're going to get started.
Yes, we are.
And talk about all kinds of fun stuff that you guys always talk about. And you're probably going to edit some bad stuff out, like these wrinkles. Can we, is there any way that we can...
We buff them out. You got to see my nose after post production. It's gorgeous. Whoa!
Everybody sees your nose, man, from space, bro. Anyway.
Ernie, can you see it from space?
Yes.
It's like the Great Wall of China. What are you talking about?
Oh man, I'm really happy to be on the show. Actually, man, this is great.
We've been going back and forth with topics. Obviously there's a million topics to cover. I don't know why we settled on this. Obviously you're a big music guy, you know, toured the world a million times over, but we settled on, are you ready for this, everybody? Top five action TV shows from the 70s and 80s.
Right.
I mean, it's the perfect topic for you. It's what everyone would think about when they hear Eric Martin from Mr. Big, right?
Well, is that a joke? Because everybody would think that it's just like music this and music that. I'm like, I'm one of those guys that know a little bit about everything. That's how I got over on all the girlfriends. Anyway, I'm a big movie and TV buff, just like you guys are. I'm wearing the Kiss shirt tonight, I don't know about Kiss too much. So, I didn't want to do that kind of format, but I love the action film stuff and TV. Yeah.
Well, but before we dive into it, I know, when we were on the road together a couple weeks ago, you were talking about the show and you were mentioning our other co-host who is not with us today because he's, I think he's, have a softball game, Ern?
Who cares? I mean, who knows?
And you were mentioning how poor Ernie very rarely can get a word in edgewise. Am I right?
Yeah. I'm going to really try to not copycat him. So I have a problem of interrupting, ask any of my wives. But I'll kind of dumb it down too. Yeah. But am I auditioning for the role as the third member?
I mean, listen, that spot is always in flux. So, yes, you're more than welcome to take that over. Because as you've seen, every once in a while, the doctor could dip back a couple too many and the show lasts 17 hours. So if we can get through a nice quick hour show with you, you might be in.
Good luck, though. I mean, Mr. Big Mouth over here. I don't know.
Good point.
You've seen it. Good point.
Well, I will tell you this. If you and the doctor were on the same episode, it would be... absolute disaster. It would be interrupt
point,
city.
Counterpoint. No point, counterpoint, no point. Yeah.
All right. So, let's just dive in. So, let's figure out. We're going to obviously make Eric go first. He's our guest. We have no rules. Usually, Ernie has 20, 30 rules, and he sends me a text. We got to do take this off the board, and we're not allowed to say this. I texted him today. Any Ernie rules? He said, nope. Everything's on the table. So, Eric, lead the way.
Oh, really? Oh, shit. Did I just cut you guys off?
No, you're good.
No, I can't find my shit. Hold on.
Uh-oh, his list. He can't remember five.
No, I can find my list. I just don't know where you guys are. Let's see. Oh. Okay, hold on.
No rules.
I don't have to go first. you guys are going to talk about all these, like...
No, don't name anything. Don't give it away.
I'm not going to say it, but all right, look, I know this is not my format and I know I'm going to screw the pooch on this show, but okay. So number five, kind of favorite action show. The kind of action that I like was stuff like a car crash kind of stuff. And let me start it again, because I'm blowing this whole situation. All right.
We'll edit it out. We're good.
I know you.
We will make you look beautiful, I promise.
Yeah, bullshit. I should be drinking. I probably would have like a little bit more spark.
Get a drink. What are you doing?
Yeah. all right. So my favorite action show. This is probably not your kind of action show, but the action show that I was totally digging when I was younger was a TV show from 1968, but it like went all the way to 1980.
Oh,
so you got to give me 2 years.
Oh,
right?
Yeah, well, you can have that.
All right, so Hawaii 5-0.
Ooh, all right.
Hawaii 5-0. I mean, you know, we said we weren't going to talk about, or I said I wasn't going to talk about music, just mainly about TV shows, but the music in general of Hawaii 5-0, it was by, who did it? Morton, somebody, I can't remember, but The Ventures covered it. And right off the bat, when you see Steve McGarrett, you know, Jack Lord, right? You see Jack Lord going, kind of the, he was the original at doing that kind of face thing with like that action hero face, da 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 da, which was what's that guy, Caruso from my CSI Miami, which is
yeah
the stunt cock of Jack Lord. Anyway, he was like da 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 da. Anyway, the one of the coolest shows where it was just so gritty back in the day, where my parents would kind of keep me away from the television set. They didn't want me to see all this like blood and gore and that kind of stuff. And Hawaii 5-0 was had terrorism and kidnapping and underworld drug kingpins like WoFat.
I didn't realize it was for 12 seasons. Wow.
Oh man, 12 seasons of this stuff. And I think WoFat, you know, Jack Lord's nemesis was he was like the villain in pretty much all of them.
Right.
It was believable, you know? But you know, like Jack Lord and what's the guy, James MacArthur. He was in all those Walt Disney movies and stuff, but pretty intense cast. A lot of like, you know, close-up camera action. It was like, anyway, I know that's not the full-on action, but...
No, that's total. There's different kinds of action. We're going to go across the gamut here. There's the cop action drama like you're doing right now. There's so many different ones, but that's a great start. And I was going to say, too, great themes. I have a feeling a lot of our stuff is going to have so many of these great theme songs where I just don't know if they... Do they still do that today? Do shows really have those killer theme songs like they had back then? Or maybe we were just kids and we gravitated towards it because, you know, we would hear that song every week and we would know it by heart.
The television shows back in the day were just, you know, there was this guy, Mike Post, that was kind of like big in those kind of, a lot of wah-wah pedal. And I think he used...
The 70's, all that stuff was wah-wah stuff, right?
Well, it was, you know who played guitar and a lot of that stuff? Larry Carlton.
Who's that? From what?
Kind of a jazz kind of guy, around the same. Kind of like Steve Lukather was, I think Larry Carlton was a mentor of Steve Lukather back in the day, but like just a all around kind of great session player. But Mike Post did all these like wonderful cop shows.
Great start. I actually like that pick. What do you got, Ern? Number five.
My number five is a little different type of action. Starring one of the greatest singers of all time, Baywatch.
Ha ha ha. even think Baywatch as when I hear action, but I guess you're right.
I really got much enjoyment out of watching the show. I mean, okay, some of the stories were asinine, but the development was titillating.
Oh, jeez. You know,
Ernie, what kind of reminds me, you go, yeah, I got a lot of, good feelings out of that show. It's kind of like where guys used to say, yeah, I read Playboy for the stories.
Exactly. <know? laughs>
Was it that obvious?
I mean, they always said Eric Martin was no David Hasselhoff.
Did they say that?
I think I've heard that before. Yeah, I read that. I read that in Playboy one time.
Playboy After Dark. You know, I go to Germany a lot, and David Hasselhoff is still like top 10 singer over there.
Does he still tour singing?
I don't know. I mean, I see his name out there once in a while. Listen, it seems kind of a joke, but he's got a great voice. You know, I mean, like if you like the, excuse me, the Engelbert Humperdincks,
right.
Joey, you're probably a huge fan.
Big Engelbert fan. Yeah.
Yeah, but Hasselhoff does have a great, I'm not going to say great voice, but he has a pleasing voice. And plus, you know, you got to hang on the beach, just like Ern said, with all those hot chicks, you know.
Now, Ern, when you talk about Baywatch.
That's right.
Good pick. I mean, I would like to say good pick. Not really a great pick. a dirty old man pick, but I respect it.
What kind of action was there? Like, you know, like, save me. And like, you know, Hasselhoff would send out, all the cleavage out to go.
Yeah, they're running on the beach in slow motion. That's action.
That's action.
Hey. What if I told you that 65% of the audience was female for that show?
Is that, no, how could that be?
Yeah, it couldn't be.
To have strong female leads doing the exact same, saving lives as just as men.
Yeah, I get it.
So you guys are talking about legitimate shows. What's going on here, man?
All right. I got a legitimate show. Here we go. So I'm going obviously a little newer. I'm a little younger. But not only is it one of my favorite shows, especially from the 80s, theme song-wise too, it's just I hadn't heard it for a while, and I just listened to it again today. It is such a killer theme song. I don't even know if you guys will know the theme. But cop show, undercover cops, 21 Jump Street.
Oh,
God damn it.
Love it.
I see it.
Johnny Depp. You have
yes.
Dom DeLuise's son. I think his name was Peter DeLuise. So great in that show. Holly Robinson, who sings the theme, which I didn't know, I think, probably until the show was off the air. I had no idea that was even her singing it. That theme song is so good. It's just a great premise. You know, I was, you know, young. I was a teenager during when that came out. So they're undercover in high schools. So it was such a great show to watch during the years that I grew up in.
I agree. I think it was a pretty good show as well. And that's probably talking about PJ Farley and Steve Brown. That's where they got that flannel shirt vibe from Johnny Depp and 21 Jump Street. I'm pretty sure.
I never thought of that. I never thought of those bastards.
I know.
I think you're right.
I mean, Pearl Jam and some of those other indie folks, I'm not saying they stole it from Trixter, but Trixter had to get it somewhere. You know?
Well, Trixter was first with that stuff, but you're right. 21 Jump Street, Johnny Depp was first. You heard it here. Breaking news. Blabbermouth, pick this up. Breaking news. Pick it up. I don't know. Metal Sludge, what the hell it is? I don't know what the hell websites are. Any of those metal websites, here, you heard it here first. Eric Martin said Trickster ripped off 21 Jump Street.
Any of those metal websites knows Trickster? I don't think so, but still. Look, you know, I'm not making a joke. I mean, Johnny Depp, you know, wore that, he rocked that flannel. And around his waist. Remember that? That was his thing. That was his look. He was kind of like the tough guy.
And now that I'm even thinking about it, what's his name from Breakfast Club kind of even did it before that, right?
Judd Nelson.
Yeah. That was his look in Breakfast Club, which was Trickster's look. Those, oh my God, yeah. Those plagiarist bastards.
Those bastards.
Could the PJ stand for Pearl Jam?
Pearl what? Jam stole the name from PJ Farley? Pearl Jam? Could it be PJ? No. Breaking news here, folks. Top five.
First of all, can I just interject one thing? You know, I don't know if you can edit this out or not, but like one thing, you know, when I was watching The Doctor and then I'm like studying Ern, and Ern is so funny and kind of deadpan, just like you are, you know, but I love the whole, it's always a kind of a green beer, like a green bottle beer. And it always comes out of nowhere. It's like, and it's always kind of a sideways. Yeah. And it was when you hold it up in space like that, it's transparent. You see that?
Yeah. Yes. That's the virtual background crap.
But I think Eric, wait, what did you compare us to when I say, "Hey, Ern"?
Hey, Bert.
Oh, yeah. Because you guys were talking about cartoons the other day, and you're totally like, you're Barney and Ern's Barney and you're Fred. You're like, "Hey, Ern." That's how you talk to the guy all the time in every podcast. Like, "Hey, Ern. Hey, Joe.
Here we are, Barney boy. Costumers. What kind of costume you gonna get?"
"Well, I'm gonna get something that makes me look tall.
How about another head?"
You know, it's the same. And the beer thing is just kills me. It's out of nowhere. I wish I could had a liquor bottle to do this, but it's like, comes out of nowhere. And then it's always like, "Yeah, I hear you. Up by the sailor." Anyway.
Well, speaking of which, we're back to you. We're back to you, Eric. Number four, what do you got?
Shit. All right. Well, this is one of my favorite. I love when you said action shows. I didn't go for the, I like the more believable shows. And I specifically like this one. My number four pick is The Streets of San Francisco. Michael Douglas and the great Carl Malden. That's pretty much, I mean, I didn't really know who Michael Douglas was in the beginning. I knew he was kind of he had something to do with One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest that he produced or something like that. But Carl Malden was one of my favorite actors back in the day, because I love character actors. He was opposite of Paul Newman in The Cincinnati Kid. I don't know if you ever saw that movie.
Love it.
Great
yep.
movie. His character was Shooter, and he was kind of like the, you know, like the head honcho, kind of the boss man, the whole thing. But he was just a great presence, and also Streetcar Named Desire. He was a wonderful actor. But anyway, I grew up in San Francisco, and I lived with my father in sophomore year or something in San Francisco. And he used to take me to school, and we would see them filming like on all the streets, you know, streets of San Francisco. And a couple times my father said, "Hey," he had to go to, you know, my dad was in the Army, so he was going to the Presidio, and then he was dropping me off at Galileo High School in San Francisco. But sometimes we'd just skip it all together and just like park our car and just watch them film. It was pretty cool.
Nice. What year was that on?
It was... I want to say that was early 70s.
Early 70s, right? Yeah.
Yeah, but it went on for a while. And it didn't go on that long, like maybe six, 6-7 years. A lot of those shows did, but like, you know, God, I've watched every episode to, you know, like, I know I don't want to give away some of your stuff, but I like, you know, a lot of those shows back in the day were like 6 or 7 years, right. But in reruns, man, you like watch
them. Oh, they're on forever. Right. Of course.
But,
I've seen a couple episodes. I don't know that show that well. I've obviously seen it a couple times, but it wasn't a show. And even honestly, even in reruns, that's not something you see that often, right?
No.
Like Hawaii 5-0 is all over the place. You can find that anywhere. Yeah. TV Land and all this other stuff. But I never see Streets of San Francisco anywhere.
You know, you don't. It's one of those rare shows. I mean, it's one of those things, that, you know, it's something that I grew up watching. I was there in person watching. There's a famous street. A famous street. I can't even remember the name of it. It's downtown San Francisco. And it's like, you know, like, we have like those kind of up and down kind of streets, but it's like overlooking the bay. And there's a famous scene with Steve McQueen in Bullet flying over those streets.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know if you remember that.
Yep.
But, you know, Carl Malden and Michael Douglas flying over these streets, you know, a lot of car chasing and screeching out. And like when you watch it now, at the time when I was watching, I go, these. Man, look at those clothes. Look at those guys. You
know? Of course.
And it's like, you watch it now, man. It's like penny loafers and like a.
Yeah, but that's the time. They were, you know, that's the time.
Yeah. But it was, and Michael Douglas had these mutton chops, you know, and Carl Malden, you know, had a bigger nose than you, Joe.
Whoa.
I mean, hey, huge.
This is only on the internet. This in person, this is beautiful. You know that.
Oh, dude, I've seen it in person, just like Streets of San Francisco. It's statue-esque. Yeah. All the esques.
Son of a bitch. Yeah. Bernie, what do you got? Number 4.
I never heard of that show.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, you gotta come out of your mom's basement, bud. Oh. You got to do it.
No way.
Rent-free. What are you talking about?
Is that what you said? Carl Malden, is it?
Yeah.
The guy who discovered communism?
What? Yeah, that would be Karl Marx.
Oh.
You moron.
All right, not my number 4.
Give me something.
All right, number 4, I put the $6 million man.
Steve Austin, astronaut. A man barely alive. Gentlemen, we can rebuild him. We have the technology. We have the capability to make the world's first bionic man. Steve Austin will be that man. Better than he was before. Better. Stronger. Faster.
It might be more now, but
that's 6 billion probably today, right?
Yeah, this is the first non-children show I can remember. It ran from 73 to 78, so it began when I was 3 years old. I don't know where my parents were.
I mean, that's what a killer show. Yeah, good show.
Yeah.
How many seasons earn? Say it again.
73 to 78, so we're talking about 5 or 6.
And how many seasons in did they get the spinoff, The Bionic Woman?
I'm gonna guess.
Oh, that's a tough question.
Because they ran at the same time, right? Because I remember them crossing over into each other's shows.
When $6 million man was near the end, Billion dollar woman, I almost said.
I got to tell you, as I mean, obviously, you know, Lee Majors, he was so good in that show. But Bionic Woman, for me, even though I guess the Lindsay Wagner character is not as strong as he was, just as a character, I thought the Bionic Woman show was actually better. I know it's probably sacrilege, but I always thought it was, I always liked that show better.
Oscar Goldman.
Yeah, of course.
Oh, yeah. They didn't. both of those television shows had that that kind of theme, like, you know?
And it's so cheesy, like, looking back, but it was so great back then when you see and that sound effect, it's ridiculous and it's so cheap to do, but it was perfect for the time. It's actually better. Like, I watched some of this big Michael Bay, you know, Transformers and all these big giant action movies he does. He has so much stuff going on, I can't see anything. Yeah. It's so fast. It's so, you know, convoluted. You can't see anything that's happening. I would much rather a slow motion punch like this, like in Rocky II, than the fight. Yeah. I would much, you know what I mean? It's just more effective that way.
Yeah. How many times did we do that when we were kids too, you know, going like everywhere I was running, and then that would be like a joke, and you're like, oh God, that's so funny. $6 million man, bionic woman.
And you go to fight with your friends, and you, if you went, they would slow down too to take the punch. You go, they go.
My brother and I did that like throughout all of our childhood, you know, like our teens, going like this.
We all did that, classic. Yeah, to me, that's what really stands the test of time too. Like, I don't even remember a lot of the storylines. Obviously, I'm a big wrestling fan. Andre the Giant was in $6 Million Man. He was Bigfoot for one season, and then they replaced him with the James Bond villain, the guy who played Jaws.
Richard Kiel.
And I don't even know what happened, why they replaced him, but they switched actors. But I remember loving it because Andre was in it too, and kind of gravitating towards it because of that. But yeah, great pick. As much as I love the cop shows, I'm more of those sci-fi action show fan than I am. I love the cop shows too, but yeah, I'm definitely the sci-fi kid, the nerd sci-fi kid.
Oh, no question about you, that you're a nerd. But what? No. I'm glad you're bringing up these kind of shows. I wish we would have done this episode in the 2-year lockdown COVID situation. Because I could still do it. I'm gonna go back and watch Bionic Woman, not mainly because of Andre the Giant. No offense, mainly because of Lindsay Wagner. Good God, girl.
Yeah. And honestly, that's one of the main reasons we started this show. We started this show during the pandemic. And I love doing it because even stuff like Streets of San Francisco, God, I haven't even heard that name in 25 years. So I love talking to other people because there's so many things you forget when you're growing up, things you liked and you saw, you just don't even remember anymore. I like talking about it. And then we get so many emails. Hey, this is our top 5 list. And they have so many different picks than us. And then I'll go down that rabbit hole and watch all that stuff. Like, Ern, we got so many emails. Remember the cartoon episode we just did with The Hobbit, when we were talking about the Hobbit songs? People were losing their minds. They were like, oh my God, I totally forgot about that since the movies came out. That was my favorite cartoon growing up. We got a lot of emails like that.
You know, to say something about that too, did you get my email about, you know, what I was saying, what Ern was liking that? Was it the unicorn or?
Oh, Last Unicorn, right?
Last Unicorn. And I mentioned to you, I don't know if you told Ern this, that the guy who sang that song was Dewey Bunnell from the band America.
Right, very cool.
Yeah, he left me a message one night. I know that song. I know a guy who sang that song.
Sorry that I know, I'm a fan. Maybe I should just dumb it down. Maybe I shouldn't stalk you like everybody. All right.
It's all right. We're going to have you back, Eric. It's okay. Just calm down.
I'll get it together, guys. Don't worry.
I know the nerves are setting in. You're going to be okay.
I know. I'm.
Maybe the horse with no name was actually a unicorn.
I like it.
Hold on for a minute.
Here we
Hey, Ern.
All right, here we go. My pick, what are we up to? Number 4, right? So it's not necessarily the same lines as $6 Million Man, but it's that genre for sure. Next decade, we're going into the 80s again.
All right.
I actually just rewatched some of these episodes recently, and it actually holds up. I didn't think it was going to because I remember it as a kid, loving it. And I figured, this is not going to be any good now. And I watched it again. It's actually more serious than I remember it being. I remember it because of there's a superhero aspect to it. And that's what I remember about it. And same thing, one of the greatest theme songs of all time, The Greatest American Hero.
Another Mike Post, actually.
Oh, is that Mike Post? Is that Mike Post? I don't know.
Believe it or not.
Yep.
Yeah, I think that's my post. I think, God.
Just killer song, great, crazy concept. He finds this suit. The aliens drop this suit and he finds it. But if I don't know if you remember the very first episode, he loses the instruction booklet. And he has no idea how to work the suit or his powers. And he's crashing into buildings. And it's just a great concept. And it's actually a lot more serious than I remember it being. Like some of the subject matter, like, you know, abuse and stuff like that was through these episodes that you don't realize as a kid because I'm just watching. I want to see him fly and crash into a building. I don't care, you know, if the little kid, if the father is an alcoholic and all that stuff. I'm not even watching that stuff. I'm watching the guy fly with a cape. I don't care, you know, about that stuff, but still holds up. Really good show.
What's that kid's name?
The actor?
Yeah.
Ernie, remember his name? Curly blonde.
Maybe William something? He was in Carrie.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. He was one of the bad guys in Carrie. Yes.
Look it up. What's his name?
William Cat, maybe?
Yes. That's. Yeah. I don't know if it's William. No. Cat sounds familiar, but hold on.
Cat Williams. There you go. No, that's.
No.
That could be it too.
Definitely not.
No. It was also in the story about the movie House.
Yeah, William Cat or Cott, K-A-T-T.
I would pronounce that cat, by the way.
Cat or cot?
Yeah, I would say cat, too.
I'm a little more sophisticated. I'm sophisticated. I pronounce things a little
I'm from Germany.
Cat. Cat. I think that's... No, I'm not going to go there. We'll have to edit it out anyway.
All right.
All righty. What do you got? Number three.
Oh, my God, man. I just went nuts on the cop shows, man. I'm sorry. Okay, number three for me, another gritty, blood and guts, great character actors, musically, it's like the Mike Post hour, Hill Street Blues.
Oh, yeah.
Dispatch, we have a 911. I'm Robin. See surplus store corner, People's Drive, 124th Street.
I mean, I just love that show so much. I mean, mainly because of, what's her name? Veronica Harnell. Harnell. She was, Daniel J. Trevante was Captain Fiorello. I don't know if you've watched that. Ern, did you ever watch that show?
I didn't. I remember the song, but I never watched it.
Hill Street Blues.
Dun, dun, dun. Or was that St. Elsewhere?
St. Elsewhere's a good show, too. Wait, oh, yeah, what's the... Give me the Hill Street Blues theme. Come on, Eric.
Oh, okay, again, Mike Post, Larry Carlton did the music again. I love the theme songs from all these great television shows, but Daniel J. Trevante, I don't know if he ever did anything after this or before, but he was a really great actor. And I remember meeting, like, police back in the day, you know, coming to the shows or whatever, and ask him, hey, man, do you ever watch Hill Street Blues? And he goes, and... Most of the people that you talk to, like that are in uniform, they always go, rescue me. That would never happen or stuff like that, right? And, but they identified with Hill Street Blues. They said it was pretty realistic and pretty intense, you know? It's all about
Hill Street Blues, obviously I've seen it before, but that was one of the biggest shows of the 80s. That was the number one show for a long time, right?
Oh, man, I used to go, when I was on the road with Mr. Big and all those in our, throughout the 90s, I was watching the reruns of Hill Street Blues. You know, I watched it a little bit in the 80s, of course, but I was watching a lot of the reruns. And I would play the gig as fast as I could to go back, you know, and turn on the VCR, you know. So
if only the fans knew. Where's Eric? Why isn't he signing autographs? He's in the bus watching Hill Street Blues. Yeah, right.
You're like, addicted to that rush. Good night. Thank you very much. You know.
Episode 14, season 3.
Yeah, right.
Great pick. Yeah, I mean, undeniable. Great show.
I know.
Well, we're on a text thread with Jericho and all those guys. And Ernie, these two mopes have been talking about soap operas for the last week. I wake up in the morning, I have 74 texts about, what's the soap you watch? All My Children?
All My Children.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, my God. That's why you when call my friends situation. I was making one of my first solo records, like 1985 or something, and my producer called me at the hotel and said, "Hey, get over here! Everybody's waiting for you, all the session players and all that." And I'm like, "Yeah, yeah, I'll be right over." And then I call my friend Hollis, who's like 6'4", big macho guy, and I go, "Can you believe what Susan Lucci's wearing today?" You know.
The glamorous life behind the scenes of the rock star.
I used to share a room with Paul Gilbert, and then Billy Sheehan would share a room with Pat Torpey back in the early days, you know, at Motel Sixes and all that stuff across America. And like all day long, Paul Gilbert, and I'm like, dude, shut up. You know, shut up.
And I'm watching All My Children.
I'm watching All My Children. You're not going to get better, E, unless you know, I'm like, I don't care. The Ice Princess, General Hospital, you know, anyway. Yeah.
I'm trying to remember All My Children. Was that with the Luke and Leia, the couple?
Oh, man. Hey, you know.
Ernie's quiet, but when he comes up with one, he hits you.
No, it's great. If you pull back the curtains, you can actually see the sun. Yeah, Ern. Come out.
All right, Ern. It's your chance. What do you got? Number three.
My number three, I'm Hasselhoff again. Knight Rider.
Oh.
Knight Rider. A shadowy flight into the dangerous world of a man who does not exist.
I was gonna say.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
The car was one of the coolest things I ever saw. I mean, how come the Batmobile never talked?
It's a great, great fucking question.
I bet it did. And Batman had that part removed. Because he was scared the Batmobile would give away his secret identity under torture.
You know what? You might be right.
Yeah.
Something to think about.
Knight Rider. I mean, I honestly don't remember. I remember Knight Rider the same way as Hill Street Blues. I remember Kit, of course. I remember the freaking, you know, like the Cylon, you know, I don't know if I'm giving a show away later, the Cylon thing going across the front of Kit's car. And yeah. But I don't really remember the storylines. Like, what was my? I mean, his name was Michael Knight. Was he a cop? Yep. What was he?
He was a Batman type of guy. If I remember correctly.
Just like, but like a private investigator, or like.
Well, I don't remember. I do but remember the theme song played on a rubber band.
What's the theme song for Knight Rider?
No.
Oh, yes, yes. Hold on, I'm looking it up right. I mean, I'll insert it in.
I never watched that show, but I did watch that whole, like, you know, I watched the beginning. You know, like, I wish, what was the voice of Kit? Was it?
Yeah, I don't know who voiced Kit. Ernie, come on.
Hello Michael. I don't know.
Hello, Michael. And then he'd be, you know, David Hasselhoff would be all kind of cool and doing that smarmy look of his, jumping in the car. And then I'd walk over to the TV set because there was no remote control. And I would take that gigantic dial and go, yeah, I only watched the beginning, but Yeah, who was Kid? I want to.
Hold on a second.
Don't tell me. I know who it is in my head. I think I know who it is. And he was it the guy?
Ernie mentioned the show that he was in before.
In what? In this episode?
Yeah. There's another show that he starred in on screen, not obviously not as a voice.
I think I know who it is. I know who it is. It can't be Oscar Goldman.
No, but it's someone like that.
Okay, was it the guy that was? Was it? I don't want to give away your shows. Is it one of our shows that we're gonna do?
I don't think so. But Ernie mentioned it before when you said Hill Street Blues. He mentioned Saint Elsewhere. His name is William Daniels.
Oh yeah, wasn't he Charles?
Mr. Belvedere?
That's Kit. No, that's not Mr. Belvedere. Is he? Is he from Mr. Belvedere too?
It looks like him.
Is he the dad in Mr. Belvedere? Oh, he's in Boy Meets World too.
Of course he is.
Well, he's the teacher.
Yeah.
Well, the principal.
Look at this. See, top five. We got the trickster robbery from 21 Jump Street. We uncovered, and now we know the voice of Kit. I mean, this is, you know, this is educational TV here, children.
Yeah, this is riveting stuff.
Joe, stop mentioning 21 Jump Street for a while, please.
Uh-oh. I have a feeling that might be Ernie's number one.
Okay. Here we go.
All right. So I'm up to my number three. So Eric has been teasing me about this all week, and I don't give a shit. I'm not taking it off my list just because he's teasing me. This show is so damn good. The characters alone. I mean, obviously, you know, every episode they build a tank out of, you know, a garbage pail, but it, the A-Team.
Maybe you can hire the A-Team.
Oh, I mean, come on. If you don't, I don't give a shit. You can laugh all you want. If you don't like this show, you are un-American.
Talk amongst yourselves. I really am. Yeah.
I mean, just the characters alone. You got B.A., who, you know, he's afraid, this giant guy, Mr. T, Mohawk, just out of Rocky III. He's afraid to fly. They have to drug him every time he has to go on a plane, right?
Right.
You got Murdoch, who they just... broke out of an insane asylum. It's just the four characters alone are worth the show, just that alone. And then you had these crazy storylines. They're basically like hired guns, you know, local town is getting robbed by the, you know, the local mob guy, and they come in and, you know, set everything straight. And then of course the military comes in, they're chasing them, and they run to the next town. It's classic television.
They're mercenaries.
Mercenaries, exactly right. Mercenaries.
The only reason I didn't care for the show. I thought Mr. T's, I know, I thought Mr. T's character was cool. It's funny. I mean, he was on Johnny Carson's show all the time, you know. I can't imagine that guy walking through an airport without, you know, like, sir, can you take off the 50,000 gold chains on your chest, you know? But I did watch the show a little bit because I love George Peppard. Was one
But you're right, Peppard, yeah. Because if he was such a great actor, yeah. He held all those, you know, ridiculous characters together.
But he became ridiculous too. That's why I got this incredible actor. I don't know if he was an Academy Award winner, but he should have been, right? That was my thing, but.
My only, I had one gripe about the show. So I don't, obviously this is really nitpicking, but Mr. T early on was just a buff army guy that was in the show, you know, just like all the other characters. Then as the Mr. T persona outside in Hollywood became this larger than life character, if you watch the first season of A-Team, he's not wearing all his gold. He's a right. character. He's B.A. Baracus. He's not Mr. T. And then by like the second or third season, he's just Mr. T on the show. He's you know, he's doing all this army stuff. He's underwater swimming with 700 pounds of gold on. It's ridiculous.
I know. You know, he was, I did watch the first season a little bit, right? I mean, I like the whole, you know, Rat Patrol kind of vibe of it, you know, mercenaries, but they were kind of funny a little bit, you know. Who was the actor that was Mr. T, it was George Papard, but who was Murdoch?
Murdoch, I don't remember the actor's name, but then you had Face was Gregory Peck? No, what's his name?
Gregory Peck.
Not his, it's something like that. What's it, the guy from Battlestar Galactica. What's his name, Ernie? Gregory Peck. Jesus Christ. Hold on.
Face. I'm getting a Derek something, no?
Team Gregory Peck.
Oh man, I didn't watch that show though. I got a bunch of sci-fi friends are gonna slap me around.
Dirk Benedict. Dirk Benedict.
Oh, yeah. he was a star of Battlestar.
Right. Yeah. He was Starbuck, right.
Yeah. Anyhow.
Anyway, you can laugh all you want. I don't care. I love it. I'll take the A-Team van over the Knight Rider car any day of the week.
Oh.
But that van didn't talk.
That's true.
So B.A. Baracus was turning into B.A.T.? He's turning into Mr. T?
Yeah, they morphed. It was ridiculous. If you watched like the third season, he's full Mr. T'd up, building a tank with all this gold. It's ridiculous. He can't even walk. There's so much gold on him.
Eric, you mentioned How the West Was Won before. There was a sequel that they were working on at one time. How the West Was Won 2. They didn't go through with it for some reason.
I like it. It was a great movie, Aaron. I know you're making a joke here, but How the West Was Won, man, that was like, it was a thing called CinemaScope or some kind of a new invention where they had like a full-on, not 3D, but they had, when you go to,
are you talking about color TV, Eric? What are you talking about here?
No, I'm not. Yeah, something a little called color TV.
All right, Mr. Big Shot.
Good.
What do you got? Number two.
I'm not good. I got all these cop kind of shows thing that I'm. That's what I equate action, you know. So, all right, this show could have been my first choice. But I thought the show was the epitome of action. It had guns, cars, boats, hot chicks in bikinis, and rock and roll. I mean, like every...
Interesting.
I don't know if you know what I'm going to say, but like every rock and roll band, Frank Zappa was
Hold
in
on.
It.
Hold on, any guesses? Ernie, oh wait, the only I could think of one show. Ernie, any guesses
wait,
here?
Let me
don't
do it.
Say it, don't say it. Go ahead.
Anyway, yeah. ZZ Top had music in it. Glenn Frey, that's probably a giveaway.
Okay, that's it.
Miami Vice. Miami Vice. I mean, huge impact of popular culture. I mean, clothes, music. It should have been my number one, but my number one's superior. But anyways, number two, music was off the hook. Yeah, like ZZ Top. They had like, I mean, from Duran Duran to the Tubes to Foreigner. Boatloads of music.
Well, I think you hit it on the head too. Pop culture wise, show was across the board, everything from fashion to, like you said, just characters and music. Maybe I'm wrong, but was there other shows before this that really integrated popular music into their shows? Obviously, it was generic, soundtrack stuff, but not necessarily pop hits, right?
No. There were rock hits as well. You know? I mean, like, I think maybe the first time I heard some new music from ZZ Top was on Miami Vice, you know, but
and rock star guest stars all the time too, right? I think I know Gene Simmons was in a couple episodes. I think Phil Collins was in a couple episodes, right?
Miles Davis was on the show. Anyway, yeah, they had a lot of diverse musicians, actors, and that kind of stuff. But ironically, you know, so they had all this great rock and roll music and pop songs in the show. But the show's theme song, it left me a little flat. I mean, it was just kind of a bluesy kind of chord progression, you know, like it modulate keys maybe two or three times. And all it was like syndromes, you know, it got to the point of like, you know, when you want, we used to make fun of like Entertainment Tonight, right? This thing was over the top, Simmons and syndromes, you know.
Really captured that era, that's for sure.
Yeah, big time.
But again, like, one of those shows, I know everything. I've watched it hundreds of times. I can't think of really one straight episode like this storyline or that. I just, you know, I just remember Crockett and Tubbs kind of walking in, looking cool to some great music. And I don't really remember the storylines.
There was all kinds of, a lot of drug smuggling stuff.
Right.
You know, it was in, I mean, Miami, you know,
of course.
A lot of dancing, a lot of, you know.
Damn Cubans.
Cuba Libras, you know, and so a lot of drugs. But I don't know if you know, here I am when I'm younger and I'm trying to emulate the rock stars of the 70s, you know, kind of wearing, I don't know, bell-bottom pants or fringe jackets. And then I got into like the leather jackets and that goddamn Miami Vice, man. I had to get one of those, like, those coats that had that
the white blazers and
shark skin, and then you go,
oh yeah, roll the sleeves up.
Oh my god, dude, lately I've been seeing some videos of me from the 80s with my mullet, you know, or like I used to call it a bono, because I thought it was cooler to say that it was a bono in the name of love video. But yeah, and then back in the day when I thought, oh man, I'm sweating like a pig up here. And I go like that and I go, dude, that is so cool, man. Sonny Crockett.
No, I'm just hot right now.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, great choice. I can't deny it. It's one of the, if not the biggest show, is there a bigger show, cop show in the 80s than Miami Vice? I don't think so.
I don't
give anything away, but I can't think of one that impacted, you know, the generation more than that.
No, I don't think so at all. I mean, it had everything: fashion, rock and roll, you know, did I say fashion? Cool hairdos.
Speaking of cool hairdos, right. Bernie, what do you got?
Oh man.
One
of the greatest theme songs ever. Dukes of Hazzard.
Just a good old boy, never meaning no harm. Beats all you never saw, been in trouble with the law since the day they was born.
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
I can still tell you what day and time and channel this was on.
Channel 2, right?
Friday, 9 p.m., Channel 2.
It's a little different in California.
Right, but so Channel 2 was what? CBS, right?
Yeah, still is.
Right, well, you know what I mean. I never called them CBS, ABC. It was 2, 4, and 7 for us in New York, Ern.
We're talking about Dukes of Hazzard, though. I couldn't wait to one day get my own car so I could jump over these little one-foot trenches in the ground, which are all over the place in this show. Like Hazard County could use a little more infrastructure, I would imagine.
They need to work on the roads a little bit. Yeah, I agree. Never use the doors, right? Did the doors even open?
I don't think so.
No, they always slid in, right?
Right. Yeah. But it's so cool. It's ridiculous, but it's the coolest thing in the world. They were too cool to open the doors.
You know, that show was like a kind of a spinoff of a movie. I think White Lightning or Burt Reynolds' movie Gator.
Right.
Yeah.
There was like, you know, they were running moonshine, right?
Yep.
And that kind of the premise. I mean, I thought you were going to, Gern, I didn't think you would say this, but I mean, the action part for me was Daisy Duke's shorts I mean,
oh man,
this goes without saying, you know.
I mean, speaking of pop culture impact, I mean, come on,
right? Oh my God, this is, what was that, the 70s? Or, no, that was the 80s, right?
I think it started in the 70s, right?
79. Late 70s,
yeah,
yeah. Oh my God, girl, I could totally see a couple of my girlfriends back in the day going, you know, do you want me to wash your car? I'm like, oh God, please, you know. You know, and I'm sitting in like some old, you know, old airplane seat in the front yard, you know, like somebody had ripped out like some airplane seat and put it like in this junkyard. And I remember like pulling up, that's where we'd wash our cars when like in the 70s, you know.
In the junkyard? Wait, hold on.
In like in this big field, and everybody like parked their cars out like this area and like, and wash our cars. And all the chicks, we'd be wearing their Daisy Duke shorts and like, you know, one cheek sneak, you know, that kind of thing.
I think, listen, for the next run of shows that we have, Eric, maybe me and you can bring those back. We could rock those, I think.
Not I.
Eric, most of us, most of us were not rock stars. We don't know what you're talking about.
We used to take our cars to the field and wash them all together with the girls.
No girls with Daisy Dukes wanted to wash my car.
No, we would take like in the back of our high school. We had like baseball fields and stuff like that. We'd run the hoses out there like that and just wash our cars out in the up this baseball field.
We had like guys named Tony and stuff washing the cars and with their bellies hanging out of their belly shirts. That is not good.
It was the same shirts, by the way.
Same shorts, yes. They wore the same shorts.
Don't you remember like back in the day where like you, well, maybe it's just a California thing because it's, you know.
I think it was a Mr. Big thing.
Yeah.
I was in high school. I wasn't a Mr. Big then. But no, it was like cut off shorts and washing cars. And yeah, I mean like hot summer nights, man, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I was drinking a 40 with Ernie on the corner. That's what we were doing.
Exactly. Talking about like Love Gun. All right, so
no, Ernie doesn't. Believe it or not, Ernie's not a Kiss fan. Well, I mean, not really, right?
I like Kiss. I just don't like Kiss when you're around.
Oh God, I know. He's
you make me like them less.
Dude, how do you think I feel in the thread with Chris Jericho, Steve Brown, PJ Farley, me, and then Joey? And it's like, I'm on there for a second, and then these guys are all Kiss, Kiss this, and Kiss on this record, and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, hey guys, I don't know if you care, but I'm gonna go and get a life.
Yeah. How do I get out of this thread? Right?
Oh, I think he's left a couple times. We keep adding him back in. All right, so my number two. Now this, you know, you had Miami Vice at number two. All right, whatever. Dukes of Hazzard. Okay. Now this one. This is classic television. You're talking about, again, I'm a sci-fi nerd kid, especially 70s sci-fi. The effects of this show, for me, still stand up. Some people, my wife and my kids included, they can't even watch it with me. They laugh. They said, Dad, what the hell are you watching? And I put it on, and I still love it. Storylines, you ready? And theme song extraordinaire, The Land of the Lost.
Marshall, Will, and Holly on a routine expedition met the greatest earthquake ever known. High on the rapids, they struck their tiny raft, plunged them down 1,000 feet below to the land of the lost.
Come on. You know this, Eric?
You know what? It's Eric.
Did I call you something?
Do you know this, Tarek? Tarek.
Tarek is a real word.
Too much Knob Creek.
Anyway, yeah, The Land of the Lost. Is that what you said? I have heard quotes from that television show. Everybody loves that show. I have not seen one episode.
It might be, as an adult, it might be hard to get into. It's not like a new show you can get into. But as kid, this is, again, this is mid-early 70s. I'm really young. When this show came on, it's about exactly what it is. It's about this family that gets, you know, goes down these rapids and they fall down into this big, big hole, and they go thousands of feet below into the land of the lost. And there's dinosaurs, and there's these things called the Slee Stack, which as a kid were my favorite things in the world. I mean, the effects are ridiculous, of course. Like, you know, it's those effects where they used to film in front of a screen. So they would have the dinosaur claymation, and then they would actually film in front of it, of the girl running from the dinosaur. So it would, you know, they would try to kind of superimpose it, like green screen before green screen. But the storylines, you know, were just so much fun, especially as a kid when this thing used to come on. I used to lose my mind.
You know, one time I was, when I first watched that awesome movie, Galaxy Quest.
Yes, I love that movie.
And that whole, and that scene where they're in that sort of rock quarry, and those rocks kind of form this sort of monster that's chasing Tim Allen. I've had people tell me, that's still Land of the Lost. I'm like, absolutely. Yeah, huh? I don't, you know.
Ernie, you remember Land of the Lost, right?
Yes, Chaka.
Oh, Chaka, of course. Chaka.
First of all, I want to say, you know, I must have, my whole childhood, everybody said, like, you know, Land of the Lost, not, oh, nice, great. An angel got its wings. Great. Thanks. Hey, perfect. All the camera people here. Land of the Lost. I mean, all my friends watched that show, and I've heard all the characters' names, and Slee Stack or whatever.
Yeah, Slee Stack. Yeah, they were like these lizard people that lived in the caves.
Yeah, and Chaka. I've heard all these names. I just never watched this show. I feel so bad. I want to go back and watch it because I'm sure, I mean, I want to go back and watch it, but it, like you said, it's going to be more campy.
It's full on. Like I said, I was so excited to watch it with my kids when they were of age, and they were like, what the hell is this?
Well, when you were growing up, this was, I don't know if it was real to you, but this
this was top technology, action. Of course.
Yeah. I'm sure it was. That's why when you watch it now, it's going to be like, wow, I don't get it. Yeah. You have to be a kid.
Still see it through my kid eyes. So when I see it, I don't see the campiness and the bad effects. I just see what I remember seeing as a kid, loving every minute of it.
Yeah.
It's bringing you somewhere else. That's why.
Absolutely. And to me, that's what this show is about. That's what music is about. When you hear a song, what do you immediately do? You remember where you were somewhere experiencing that song, or you remember a memory, or even talking about TV shows, you immediately, Eric remembers being in a field with, you know, women all around him washing cars. I don't even know what the hell he was talking about.
Everybody remember that anyway.
Listen, I remember when I heard this on the radio. I knew exactly where I was, at the bank. All right, so.
Well, Ernie, what was that? What was that? Answer. Every Rose Has Its Thorn? What was that one?
Oh, God's sake, come on. You know what?
That was Ernie's joke. I stole it from him.
Yeah, it was good. Yeah.
All right, E. We're up to your number one. Let me recap. Hold on. We got number five, Hawaii 5-0. Number four, Streets of San Francisco.
No idea.
Number three, Hill Street Blues. Number two, I see a theme going here, Miami Vice. All right. What do you got? Number one.
I know this is gonna sound like not incredible after Miami Vice, you know, like what we're talking about here, but one of my favorite shows of the 70s and 80s. It was starred one of my favorite actors of all time. And I mean, it just had, talk about car chases and cool, like, you know, 70s clothes, and it was a gritty cop show, but it had tons of humor. And he didn't seem like, you know, some cop shows, you know, like they're, everything is way too serious. This guy kind of did took life a little less serious. The Rockford Files. James Garner. I mean, another one of Ern, probably never saw it, but like Ernie, Rockford Files.
I didn't know where you were going with. At least I've heard of that one.
I thought you were going with Columbo for some reason when you said.
Oh man, I was so close. I was so, yeah. Okay, no. Anyway, yeah, I was so close. But the Rockford Files, James Garner, and then Noah Beery Jr. He was like another great character actor. He was in a bunch of John Wayne movies back in the day. He was in Red River. I just love the acting of James Garner and Noah Beery, who was his dad. And the music, again, man, I gotta tell you. Mike Post. Again, I love this.
I mean, are we just guessing at Mike Post at all these shows, or are we sure?
I'm guessing it's Mike Post. Maybe, I think it was Mike Post, believe it or not. But the fact that, like, my dad kind of had a James Garner kind of look.
It is.
I know that part.
Love it.
And again, I have to bring up the question: are the themes really that good, or do we just love them so much because we associate it immediately with something we love?
But that's the same thing, isn't
it? Yeah, I guess you're right. Yeah,
same thing. You know, I mean, look, you know, I could tell you, I really like the show Miami Vice, but the theme song was just.
Is To Be With You a good song, or is Eric Martin just so loved that when you hear it, you think of Eric and you love the song?
No.
That's not what it is.
No.
Eric, my favorite song by you guys is More Than Words.
What?
Oh, Ern.
Yes.
Ern, I knew that, you know, I knew that you didn't know who we were or what. So I thought I would bring this out. This is a music box that a Japanese fan gave me. And I just want to play you this, Ern.
Whoops.
Can you hear it?
Joey closed it with his mind.
Heaven isn't too far. Is that
like da 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 da? It's To Be With You, man.
I'm gonna
playing in the background. Da, da.
Is that Trickster?
Yeah,
Trickster.
That's Trickster. You can pick up the check at the Trickster mailbox. Hey,
all right, Ern, we got your number one pick. Are you ready? Let's recap what you have so far.
All right.
Number five, the cult classic, Baywatch. Number four, $6 Million Man. Number three, Michael Knight, Knight Rider. Two David Hasselhoff picks already. Number two, Dukes of Hazzard, can't go wrong. Number one, I have a funny feeling someone might have mentioned it already. What do you got, Ern? Number one.
21 Jump Street.
Yes.
21 Jump Street.
Really? The forgotten reason why the Fox Channel became a contender.
You're right.
Right.
I forgot about that.
Yeah. It came only 1 week after Married with Children started.
What? Those were the first two shows on Fox?
Yeah, Fox was a channel less than a year when both of these shows came out.
Wow.
Yeah.
Great. Two great. Married with Children. So good. God.
Did you love that show to the point of, okay, I mean, if I ask you some trivia right now, like, what was the, didn't they, what school did they kind of hang out?
I know.
All different schools. They were undercover cops that would go to different high schools.
That's right. Like, what's that movie that, oh, well, it's 21 Jump Street. Oh, my God. What an idiot I am.
Right. They redid it. I never even saw those. Those were like comedies, but I think, right?
Oh, I got to tell you, I thought those movies were great.
Oh, I never saw them. Is it the same premise?
Yeah, but it's much more comic. But the two movies are great, historical.
They are great. Hey, Joe, you might want to like step away from the ironing board when you're pressing your hair and maybe go watch some of these shows, man.
I know 21 Jump Street. I didn't see the remake movies.
Oh, you got to do it, man. What do you got to do?
I'm busy. I'm on retainer. What's the matter with you?
Diddling. Hello? Get off the phone. I'm waiting for the...
No,
keep the people to call.
Keep me on the phone. I don't want the don't let the call come through.
why can't you watch a movie if you're on retainer? That's only your teeth, isn't it?
That's not that kind of retainer.
Oh. Ernie, you're like, do you write these jokes or they're funny?
He's quick.
I spend days.
And you know, I hope this show was a good show.
Whoa. I didn't do my number one yet.
Oh, Ernie, can you believe this guy? I was like, I didn't do my number two. I didn't do my number one. Hey, look, it's like going to the bathroom or something here. Come on.
Eric, I'm ready to go too, actually. I'm done here as well.
You guys can leave. I'm finishing the show, goddammit.
All right.
My number one. Again, staying with the sci-fi theme, obviously, if you look over my studio here, it's just toys and sci-fi paraphernalia. It's ridiculous.
What are those platinum records?
Well, they're gold, unfortunately, not platinum.
Oh, my eyes are kind of bad. Are they mine? Did I give them to you?
Those are silver records.
Speaking of which, yeah, where's my record, Eric? Send me a record.
Which, what album do you want?
What's that one with the elephant you just named?
Defying Gravity. I didn't mention it.
You said the wrong name. What'd you call it?
No. The album that it was when I was in Malibu was...
Slippery When What?
Was What If, I think. What'd you say?
Slippery When What?
Oh, God, Ernie.
You on that one, Eric? That's a good one.
Yeah, that is a good one.
All right, my number one pick. Sci-fi. Again, when this came out, I was a big fan of the original. When this came out, I was like, this is going to absolutely suck. I hated everything about it. I saw a character that looked like the star of the original, and I didn't even watch it for years. I refused to watch it because I was such a big fan of the original. But then, as time passed, I started to get into it, saw some reruns, and then caught up and, you know, finalized the last, I think, three or four seasons while it aired live. Star Trek, The Next Generation.
Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise. Its continuing mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no one has gone before.
Oh, The Next Generation.
Yeah, well, yeah, right. So Star Trek was 60s. So Next Generation, when that came out, I wanted no part of this. I thought, you know, Riker looked like Kirk. I thought they were trying to remake it. It just looked like crap to me. Mm-hmm. One of my favorite shows of all time. 7 seasons, 4 or 5 movies, great, great storytelling, great, just sci-fi classic stuff all the way. Either one of you fans of this show?
I never watched it.
Is that true?
I never watched it.
I watched all the Star Trek movies or television shows. I love Star Trek. I think, I don't know why I didn't watch Star Trek Generations. I got friends that are, like I said earlier, the sci-fi friends that are just going to slap me around right now.
Yeah,
they've been trying to get me to watch this show for years.
Patrick, just for Patrick Stewart alone acting, Jean-Luc Picard, he's so phenomenal. And it's funny because when they were advertising the show, I remember when they first started to bring out the show to advertise it, they kind of didn't show him as much as they showed the second in command, Riker, because Riker looked like a clone of Kirk. And that's kind of what turned me off of the show. I didn't want to watch it. And then if you notice, like second and third season, they give Riker a beard to get out of that stigma of Kirk and all that stuff. So it became its own show after a couple seasons. Great show. If you're a Star Trek fan, I'm telling you, you will love this show. Binge it.
I could tell you why I didn't watch it with 3 words. No William Shatner.
Yeah, and that's why I didn't watch it at first either. I not only no Shatner, but they were I thought they were ripping Shatner off.
Hold on, just for a second.
You know how I feel about Shatner.
Oh, I mean Shatner's. What's that show, Ernie? Finding Shatner. What is it? Finding Enterprise.
Oh, Free Enterprise.
Free Enterprise. What a great movie. Ah, so good, right?
I show my kids scenes from that movie. I love it so much.
Great movie.
Great stuff.
All right.
Would you go get the Knob Creek? Oh, baby.
Okay. What's it going to be?
What a beautiful man.
Does that say to, is that to you, Eric?
Yeah. A man of 1,000 words here. To Eric, William Shatner. That's what it says. Listen, but
that's enough.
Dude.
Now I'm jealous.
Oh, my God. This is a claim to fame for me, man.
The only thing better, if he had his shirt off in that picture, forget it.
You know, you with the Daisy Duke shorts and the thing. You know,
I mean, William Shatner, come on.
No, man, he's got that, kind of mustard yellow, you know, cool uniform thing, and it's got the insignia right there. Oh, my God. I wish you could see this better.
I mean, we see it. There's no, I mean, who the hell is cooler than Kirk, right? Am I out of my mind?
Nobody.
Yeah, and you know, when we'll bring up some honorable mentions. TJ Hooker, Ernie mentioned it earlier. Very underrated show. Very underrated.
And what was that guy? Yeah, I mean Shatner again, right?
Yeah.
But what was that guy? Adrian Zmed.
Right, from Grease from Grease 2, right?
He's going, hey, I don't know. I always looked at him, and then I remembered like Danny Terrio. It was like some dance guy back in the
Dance Fever, Danny Terrio, of course.
Right. So anyway, TJ Hooker. What are some other honorable
give a couple honorable mentions that didn't make the list.
Oh man, I can't think. You name a couple more,
Ernie. What do you got? A couple.
I forgot to write down my honorable mentions.
What the hell is going on? Oh, all right, here's a couple. The Incredible Hulk.
Lou Ferrigno.
Oh, man. Great. Bill Bixby, so well done. You actually believe this guy was the Hulk. I mean, it was insane how big he was.
Yeah.
Obviously, again, being sci-fi, Battlestar Galactica, Buck Rogers. I still watch, I DVR Buck Rogers all the time. I watch reruns all the time. The Fall Guy.
What?
The Fall Guy.
Oh, well, Lee Majors is phenomenal. But, God, what did you just say? Oh, God, I just had it.
Buck Rogers.
Quantum Leap.
Yes. But was that in 80s or 90s? If it's 80s, I messed up because that would have made my list. I love Quantum Leap. Love it.
Give me the whip. I give you the idol. I don't know.
So good.
Yeah.
You know what? A show, a big 80s action show that I remember my friends like adoring, and I just couldn't stand it. MacGyver. Never liked it.
I love MacGyver.
I don't know. I never liked it. Richard, I tried to watch it.
I don't think I've ever watched it.
He'd be trapped in a falling elevator, and he would have 4 seconds to live, and he would build a laser out of his pen and a paperclip.
Oh my God. That's another sort of pop culture thing too. Like all those macho guys, you know, in the 80s.
Like Candy, quick, give me your gum. I need to save the world.
Yeah.
It was, it's like, what?
There was a movie that was kind of like a parody of that. It was called MacGruber.
Wait, I think Jericho was in that movie, right?
Was he? Oh no!
Was he in that? I mean, I could be wrong, but I feel like he's in that movie.
It all comes back to Chris Jericho, doesn't it?
Speaking of which, that goofy bastard's on our show next week.
Oh well, he's great.
He's semi okay.
You know, do me a favor.
Great as a stretch.
No, he's pretty great. I mean, you're great too, Ern.
He's not us. He's no us. He wouldn't take the third spot from you. Put it that way.
Look. He smokes at this kind of thing. I mean, he's really good. I know, look, you got do me a favor, a little suggestion for you. Don't take the piss out of him so much, man.
That's what I do.
He's going to have you for breakfast, man. He's
no.
He's going to be one of these.
But you know why I do it. You see everyone else. Everyone else licks his anal area.
Yeah.
I can't do it. I have to do the opposite. I see everyone kissing his ass. I got to go the other way.
Look, I have a little bit of a brown nose, but Steve Brown has a bigger brown nose than I do. You know, I mean, oh my God, he's in there, you know?
I can't help it. I gotta shoot my digs.
And PJ, I mean, like, look, PJ now, man, he joined Fozzy. I mean, he's like, he can't say anything bad about that guy.
He's anyway. Officially a disciple now. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, he definitely is. But I totally get what you're doing when you bust Chris Jericho's balls, because even though he laughs it off, there's a little piece of him that just
in all honesty, I'm probably the only real Chris Jericho fan out of all of us. I love wrestling. So I actually do like him, but I can't ever admit that. And I'm going to edit this out.
Right. Well, dude, I bet you were so excited when he came on the Z-Rock show and you were like, I don't know who came up with that whole premise, but that bring the violence thing. I mean, that was brilliant.
Oh, it was so much. Ernie was a big part of this. Ernie, did you come to any filmings of Z-Rock? Yeah, a couple, right?
I was in two episodes.
He was.
Thanks for remembering.
Wait, which I remember Under the Bridge when we did the video. What other one?
When you had a Steel Panther.
Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, if you could see Ern is in the background there.
I am man in crowd.
Right. You're Zelig. All right. Cool.
Now, guys, this is a great episode. Fun picks. Again, I like doing out of the box. People don't expect when I say Eric Martin's going to be on, they're going to, you know, think right off the bat, oh, what band are they going to go for, or music? Nope. Yeah. Action TV shows, 70s and 80s. Love it.
A lot of cop shows coming out of me. You know, granted, if I ever get a chance to do the show again, I'll probably have to pay to play. But still, if I ever do the show again, I'm going to, come up with a little more variety. I mean, I definitely had a theme going there, you know. But, yeah, I enjoyed my performance.
I think you did a stellar job. Of course, you know I like drinking Eric better than non-drinking Eric. But we'll take what we can get.
Drinking Eric is a lot more funnier and quick and blah, blah. Sober Eric is kind of a stuttering John. I don't know what to tell you.
Anything to plug, E? I know. Oh, go ahead, Ern. I'm sorry.
How about top five Mr. Big deep cuts next?
Bring it.
Could do that. All right. All right. You're welcome back. Anytime you're ready to come back, open invitation.
I would love to do that. Yeah. My plug is just, celebrating the 30th anniversary of Lean Into It. Doing a lot of interviews and all that stuff and reminiscing of making the record and, I'm not going to say that, change pop culture, but we definitely had a blast making that record and had no idea that it was going to be sell, 7 million records. So. That's pretty much what I'm doing right now. Just kind of talking about that.
No, great stuff. And I think you just had a live box set come out too, right?
Yeah, couple. There's a couple of things. Lean Into It, vinyl. I think it might be like red vinyl, for collectors and stuff.
Where can people get that stuff?
Yeah. I have no fucking idea. No, no, it's a company called Evolution. Look it up online. I don't really know. I'm still, I would have my notes, wouldn't I?
You're a promo machine, Eric. You're a promo machine.
I'm a promo machine. I swear to God, I'm going to have a couple shots right now and then try to get back on the Zoom call.
But you will. So I do have in front of me, we'll be, we got a couple shows coming up in July. We'll be in Texas and Oklahoma City.
Who's we, you half a moron?
Me, like, you and Ern, right? Me, you and Ern.
Yeah. The unfuckables. All right. Hey, so you and I, Steve Brown, PJ Farley, Chris Jericho likes to call us Eric Martin and the guys that smell like soup.
It's true.
I think that's hilarious, actually.
I do love it.
I mean, I know you're laughing on the inside. I can totally see it. But
what was this meatball soup? I'll take it.
Meatball soup. Johnny Stampinato over here. It's Eric Martin. We don't have a name, but I just love when I talk about you guys, I say the knuckleheads from New Jersey. You know,
that sums us up. I mean, you can't say it any better than that. But, we're doing a couple shows. We'll be in Oklahoma City. We'll be in Texas. We'll be in Oklahoma City at Whiskey Nights on the 23rd of July. And then the Rail Club on the 24th of July. Yeah. Playing some songs from Lean Into It, right?
Yeah, actually a lot of Lean Into It songs. And we play some Trickster songs. We haven't fit any ZO2 songs in there, but I know. But like you play and give a tribute or like a homage to Pat Torpy. I think you rocking out Daddy Brother is, one of the best.
I mean, Pat was incredible. Not only his playing ability, but his feel, his tone, everything. Oh, I never got to meet him in person, but I'm sure from all the stories you told me, and also a wonderful guy.
Oh, all-American boy, in a way. You know, he's just such a great guy. But I'm so glad you said tone.
Oh, that, amazing. Oh, God.
I mean, look, not everybody has chops. But, if you're a drummer with your salt, I mean, you're going to have some great chops and you study the greats and all that. But Pat's tone was just so, it was just so present, so unique, I mean, it almost had, his style was a rock drummer, but it had a little bit of a Steve Gadd thing to it too.
Sure. And, drummer's tone, I teach drums all the time. Drum tone is not just, people think, oh, well, just get the same guy that tuned Pat's drums and tuned the drums. It's not just how you tune the drums. It's how you strike the drums. Same thing with guitar players. It's not just the amp you're playing. It's how you're playing those strings and stuff. So it's the attack so much more than the equipment you're using.
I was going to ask you this real quick. I mean, this is probably a whole new show here, but the way you play, to me, you sound like Denny Carmassi.
He's great, of course.
Yeah, but your tone has that Rock Candy Montrose kind of sound to it.
I'm definitely, even though I grew up more in the 80s, I always go for more of that 70s tone, but I like it more polished than, obviously I'm a big Bonham fan, guys like that, even tremendous Ringo fan, not so much Ringo's tone, but his playing, absolutely phenomenal, just a musical drummer, one of my all-time favorites. But yeah, I'm definitely more of that big sound, like you said, Rock Candy type feel.
You guys, another band that these guys always talk about besides Kiss is Van Halen.
Yeah.
Right? But now Van Halen,
tone, it's a unique tone. Right.
It's like, conk, conk, conk.
It's a very flat tone, but it's not a tone necessarily that I would go for, but it's a tone which you really don't hear this often. If you hear Alex Van Halen's snare drum, it's Alex.
Big time.
So that to me is almost more important than having a great tone than for him. It's Alex immediately, just like it's Eddie immediately as soon as you hear him play guitar.
Absolutely. All right.
All right, boys. Ern.
Can I leave?
Come on, Ern. Oh, man. How is it that you guys are pals? What?
I don't speak music.
I thought you... Yeah, I mean, I have some civilian friends as well, I mean, I thought that, did you like... I know you like Joey for his...
For his looks.
Or his wife makes probably really good Italian food, and you watch movies, and, probably after dinner, and the kids are going to play, and then you and Joey are going to go down in the basement and watch The Last Unicorn again.
You actually just summed up this Sunday. I think Ernie and the whole family's coming over for 4th of July.
Yeah.
But you got to understand, Eric, I have a little gripe with Ernie for the last 30 years. He's the reason Playground broke up. So, you know, still to this day, it's not a good thing.
Wait.
He's got the book. The book looks so much bigger on Zoom.
Eric, notes. It's on page 192.
All right, I'll look it up.
There, look at this.
Oh, I swear to God, I don't know how that happened. I just, you know what I mean? Dude, there's something weird and it's maybe
called magical, cool. Eric, not weird, magical.
You saw me. I went, dude, did I have that on? No.
No, you have that book memorized. Don't lie to the public. I know you.
All right, wait a minute. Hi. Ernie breaks the band up. I don't.
It's there. Trust me. But listen, if you want, we can insert a Playground deep cut into the shows maybe in July sometime.
Well, that's exciting.
Why not?
Exciting.
We play PJ Farley's solo music. You know,
exactly.
We might as well throw in a couple Playground hits or the one big Playground hit. Like, what's your favorite song that you did,
Ernie? What's the hit?
Oh, the biggest hit was My Nicole.
It came out, you know, was inspired by To Be With You, I think, probably right around the same year, and I think, right?
Yeah. The song really should be to be with someone else. It's the idea of the song.
I didn't know what it was called. I think I read it wrong. My glasses were dirty. I thought it was My Knuckle.
All right, get out of here. Speaking of knuckleheads.
Hey, enjoy your July 4th. I'm going to actually go see my sister on July 4th. Our whole Martin family are getting together. We haven't seen each other in 2 years because of the big C word. And
very nice.
Yeah, really excited.
Yeah, I think PJ mentioned that's why we're not playing M3 because of the Martin bash.
That's right, dude. Priorities, man. I mean, come on. You want to play MC? Hey, you know what? Look.
I'm with you.
I'm going to throw this in here. Mr. Big played M3. And we come out on stage. Nobody introduces us, right? We don't have any intro tape or anything. And we're playing. We play like four songs. People are just milling about. And all of a sudden, we start whipping into, like, I don't know, Addicted at Rush or something. And they're like, huh.
Oh, I know this band.
No one cares. No one gives a shit. I mean, how could that be? You know, Eric Martin and the Knuckleheads from New Jersey, M3, we would get, you know what? I think people just go there. Look, everybody has a great rock and roll time. And it's kind of like a Monsters of Rock cruise on land.
Yeah, ZO2 played M3 a couple of times. We played it a couple of times. It's exactly what you described. It's people are more hanging out with each other than caring about who's on stage. And that's fine. It's a big party. That's okay.
Yeah, it's like background music. Even like the night before when we all hang out that hotel, all the bands, all the fans, and we just like drink ourselves silly and then go, holy shoot, we got to play at 3 o'clock in the afternoon tomorrow. You know, anyway.
All right, Eric, send your fan mail to top5. With joeycasada@gmail.com. If you have any questions for me and Ernie, you can send us an email at top5. Anyone else out there, tell us some topics you want to see Eric back for. Would you want to see him back for some Mr. Big topics or something really out of the box?
I get it. Out of the box.
Get it? Now that's a segue to the end credits. Do I have to pay publishing for that?
You're going to get us sued for copyright.
Hey, send me a check. No, I tell you, you're not getting paid in Oklahoma when we play, okay?
Ernie, don't worry. We're gonna insert Heaven right there by Warren. Don't worry.
Oh, you jackass. All right.
Come here. Come say hi.
Oh, here comes kitties. Oh.
Oh, hey.
Who's that? Ernie, and that's crazy Uncle Eric.
I'm not Uncle. Hi, how you doing? I'm Eric.
Say hi.
You can call me Eric Martin. You can call me Mr. Big. I'm your dad's boss.
Joe.
He answers the phone for me.
He's crazy.